My name is Laura Mucha, and this is my very first book, and it's called Love Factually, The Science of Who, How, and Why We Love. And I just wanted to tell you a little bit about why and how I wrote the book. So I grew up with my mum and grandparents because I didn't know my dad. And when my grandfather died when I was 11, I was left with no romantic relationship to observe. And so I just didn't get them. So I started asking questions. I mean, for as long as I can remember, I asked everyone I met about really quite personal things. And then when I was in Northern Argentina speaking to a farmer in the middle of nowhere, he was 95 and had been married for 75 years, I thought, maybe I should turn this into a book. So I started, and I did hundreds of interviews across every continent with people aged 8 to 95. But the interviews were bringing up questions that I didn't know the answer to, like, when is it time to leave? And should you stay together for the children? And why do people cheat? And what is love? And does love at first sight exist? So then I delved into the research, so much research, quite painful actually. And so the result is this, which is interviews and research all kind of combined into one nifty little book. I'm here at Waterstones Piccadilly in the classic section to talk about one of the three books that I want to explore. These books I've chosen because they raise really important ideas relating to love, I think. So the first is Stendhal, Love. So Stendhal was a French novelist, and he wrote about the salt mines in Salzburg. He said, if you get a knobbly old stick and you throw it in there and take it out a few months later, you pull it out and it is encrusted with a galaxy of scintillating diamonds, I think is what he said. And he said it's the same thing in early love, that you don't see someone realistically, that you encrust them with your crystallizations. We now know a little bit of the science that might explain that. So early love or lust engage the brain's reward system. They have lower levels of serotonin as seen in people with obsessive compulsive disorder, so it's really obsessive. And the brain's reward system is the same part of the brain that's engaged if you take drugs. So it's really intoxicating and powerful. But there's another point, I think, that is raised by Stendhal's metaphor, and that is that in that moment, in that early stage of lust or love, you don't know if that person is dazzling because they are genuinely dazzling or because you have encrusted them with your own crystallizations. And you will only know that with time. We're now in the psychology section, and I wanted to talk about this book, Eric Fromm, The Art of Loving. I love this man. So in The Art of Loving, Eric Fromm distinguishes between what he calls falling in love and standing in love. Falling in love, he says, is a very temporary state, whereas standing in love is a decision. It's something that you choose, actively choose to do. And he thinks that this whole standing in love takes a lot of learning and skill. He argues that waiting and complaining and saying, I haven't fallen in love because I haven't found the right object, is basically like being a painter saying, I haven't found the right object to paint, instead of just getting on and learning the skill of painting. And I agree. Here I am in the philosophy section, and I wanted to talk about Aristotle, who I love, and his book, The Nicomachean Ethics. So people around the world, from Bolivia to Turkey, told me that they thought that romantic love should be unconditional. But that didn't really sit easily with me, because if romantic love is unconditional, or at least the love we see in romantic relationships is unconditional, then that means that people in dysfunctional relationships should just tolerate that and give their love unconditionally, accepting their partner for who they are without thinking about the consequences for them or their children. So I turned to the philosophers to see what they thought about it. In this book, Aristotle talks about friendship, but one of the types of friendship that he talks about, perfect friendship, is a lot like what an intimate relationship could or should be. And Aristotle says that a condition for that kind of friendship is that both people are good. Unhelpfully, he doesn't really go into exactly what it is to be good or how we go about it. But the key point is that he does not think that love should be unconditional. And I agree. That's not to say you should ditch your partner the moment you realise they eat with their mouth full or leave cupboard doors open. But I do think there should be some really carefully chosen conditions. I've brought you to the cookery section for a sneaky little fourth bonus book, and that is On the Side by Ed Smith. If I hadn't done my project, I wouldn't be married to the man who wrote it, Ed. Because I was a massive commitment phobe and I broke up with everyone I ever dated, including him.